Our processional hymn is hymn number 392, hymn 392. Church in Clarenville, and you notice our colors this morning are red, and that's because we are celebrating and remembering the cross of Jesus Christ. This is a holy day, and so we give God thanks this morning for the cross of Calvary. Our service of Holy Eucharist begins on page 185. Page 185. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father,
we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father,
Lord God, Lamb of God,
you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
You will find the colleague for today, the colleague for Holy Cross Sunday, printed in your bulletin. And I invite you to join me in praying the colleague. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself, may we who rejoice in the mystery of our redemption have grace to take up our cross and follow him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated for the proclamation of the prayer. First reading is taken from Numbers, chapter 21, verses 4 to 9. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way to the Red Sea, to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The appointed psalm for today's service is Psalm 98. And on page 836. It's Psalm 98, found on page 836, and we'll be doing verses 1 to 5 and the prayer at the end. We'll do it by the afters. Sing to the Lord a new song.
For he has done marvelous things.
With his right hand and his holy arm.
Has he won for himself the victory.
The Lord has made known his victory.
His righteousness has he openly shown in the sight of the nations.
He remembers his mercy and faithfulness to the house of Israel.
And all the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God.
Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands.
Lift your voice, rejoice, and sing.
Together,
Lord God, we see your righteous rule in all your works, and we join our voices with the sound of your whole creation in praising you, in and through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
The second reading is taken from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 8 to 24. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement that there are no divisions among you, but that you are united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I was baptized by none other. Oh, sorry. I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in his name. I did baptize also the household of Stephens, but beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of the age? Has not God made the foolish wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demanding signs and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn is hymn number 593. And before I read the gospel, I will be speaking with the children before they go downstairs for registration. Hymn number 593. Young people? But I'm going to have two. Come on, buddy. Come on, Ashton and Jacob. Let's the four of you come up here. Look. You two come up. Come over here. Oh, you want to stay by your girl. Okay, that's good. Wonderful. Okay, guess what I got today? Guess what I got today? Aha! And you have no idea what's in there. Right? You have no idea what's in there. Actually, I've got a few things in there. Maybe I can fool you with a couple of them. Anybody know what this is? No idea. Good! What'd you say? White out? Okay, that's what it is. White out. Okay. Let me go back in again now. This is like a treat bag, isn't it? What do I have here? Look at the top of it now. Ask Dennis Squires, he knows.
Oh,
I'm going to hurt you. Don't ask Dennis Squires, he didn't get in the bag. Eddie Racer, he told, didn't he? Yeah, that was good, yes. The reason Dennis knows is because he gave it to me. Now, I have some whiteout and I have an eraser. What do I use this for? Do you have an idea? Pardon me? Fix mistakes, that's right. To fix mistakes. Do you make mistakes sometimes? I do too. I make lots of mistakes every single day. That's right. And if I'm writing on paper, sometimes I use an eraser. And I get rid of my mistake. If I'm typing something on the computer, I can delete it and I don't have to use this. But sometimes, like we have a book in our room in there, sometimes I have to use this because we put things in the wrong column and I have to move it around. And that fixes it, right? But let's think about other kinds of mistakes that we don't make on paper. How about I went to the grocery store, or I went to A&W, or you went to McDonald's, and you gave the lady or the gentleman, whoever was there, $20 to pay for your meal. And when they gave you back the change, you counted it and you said, oh gosh, they gave me back too much change. They made a mistake. What can you and I do about that? If they gave you back too much change, they made the mistake. Well, you can't rub it out, can you? And you can't use whiteout. But what can you do? Give it back. That's right, you can give it back. You can very, in a nice, friendly way, say to the person, I think you may have made a mistake in giving me back too much change, and you can give it back. That would be a good thing to do, wouldn't it? You see, each and every day, you and I make mistakes, and they're not really mistakes. They're learning experiences. We learn from them. If a mistake is serious enough, we learn never to do it again. And sometimes it takes making the same mistake two or three times before we learn. And we say, oh gosh, I did that again, right? It's all part of who we are as boys and girls and men and women. But there's somebody who doesn't remember our mistakes. Sometimes people say to us, oh, you did that before. When are you going to stop doing that? You keep making that mistake all the time. But there's somebody who doesn't remember our mistakes. Who is it? I don't think it's Mom. Maybe not even Nan or Pop. Who is it? Jesus. That's right. Jesus doesn't remember our mistakes. I read a little story a little while ago about someone who said to Jesus, Lord, I made 3 mistakes last week. And Jesus said, what mistakes? Because Jesus forgets our mistakes. He forgives our mistakes. That's why he died on the cross. So you and I, when we make mistakes, can say not only to the person that was there at the time that we're sorry, but we can also tell God we're sorry. And through Jesus, because he died on the cross, we are forgiven. All of our mistakes are forgotten by God. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we were like that to each other? Huh? If we forgot each other's mistakes and wouldn't remind each other? But God, I want you to know this morning, God never reminds me about the mistakes I make. He never reminds Reverend Sheila or any of the choir or any people in the congregation. That's not the way God is. He loves us enough that he died for us on the cross that we're remembering today. And he forgets all about our mistakes. Our mistakes are paid for by Jesus when he went to the cross. Isn't that wonderful? Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for dying on the cross for us. Thank you for forgiving us for all our mistakes. Amen. Now, before you go down to register, I need someone to take this bag. Ashton's going to take it. And Ashton, you got one more Sunday, boy. One more Sunday. You've got to find something especially hard to put in here next Sunday. Okay, can you do that? All righty, here you go. And I'm going to ask Sydney if she would come and get the class, and you line up behind Sydney and go to Sunday school. And I know you're in for a good year of Sunday school. And I want to thank Lana, our Sunday school superintendent, and some of our Sunday school teachers who will be here eventually. I don't know if Sherman's going to be involved this year or not. I better be quiet. Someone told me Tom Marshall was premier until yesterday. And I think it was Warren who reminded me I was the rector until the 30th. But still, I better be quiet. There you go. Enjoy your time downstairs. There you go, honey. Come on, John. Okay, off you go. Have a good day, a good time down there, and we'll see you next week. For the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Lifted up that whosoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my lips and the meditation of all of our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Holy Cross Day is kind of a remembrance day, held on September the 14th, and this year it happens to fall on a Sunday. Therefore, today's lessons are tied in with this feast day. Holy Cross Day, a day in honor of Christ's self-sacrifice on the cross for our salvation. Today, we reflect on the significance of the cross, so common to the Christian life. It has become its chief symbol. Crosses are found everywhere in our churches. Our servers wear them, and they carry a cross as part of their ministry. There are many to be found in this church. Pictures have been painted, poetry and hymns written, and they come in all forms of ornaments and jewelry. Personally, I have worn a cross for years. There is no point for me to own anything else but around my neck because I never remove it. You may ask why. What is the significance of the cross to me? What is the significance of the cross to you? We can only answer for ourselves. In the gospel, we heard that no one ever went into heaven and came back to earth able to give a clear teaching about divine matters except for one, and that is Jesus, the Son of Man. He is the ladder between heaven and earth with access to both realms. We know that Jesus descended in the incarnation and took on the form of a humble baby, grew to manhood, was crucified on a cross, rose again on the third day, and some 40 days later ascended into heaven. Actually, he was present in heaven even before the incarnation, and therefore he knows the divine matters and mysteries. According to books and movies coming out on the scene in recent days, it appears that there are those who have gotten glimpses of what it is like in heaven. But no one can compare to the experience of Jesus Christ, who was there, came to us, and went back. The idea of being elevated or lifted up takes us to verse 14 of the gospel. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Moses' lifting up of the serpent is compared to the necessity of Jesus being lifted up. In today's reading from Numbers, the Israelites are growing impatient once again as they wander. It happens to be their 40th year in the desert. To enter the Promised Land, they have to cross the Edomite territory, but it's too dangerous. Therefore, after all these years, they're expected to take the long route around into the Promised Land, turn back toward the Red Sea once again. So you can visualize how they're feeling. Very much human and weary of roaming, they did what we do. They started grumbling. I cannot do this today, the weather's unfit. I cannot afford to eat because the prices are too high. Well, the Israelites expressed contempt for the manna which God was providing for them. And in their frustration, they spoke against Moses and they spoke against God. Just as these people became frustrated and angry with God, we too can have our moments, especially when things go wrong in our lives or in the lives of those close to us. As a result of their reaction, God sent poisonous serpents, and many Israelites died. Desperate, the people urged Moses to intercede before God for them, which he did. Again, we can relate here, for we often seek others to pray on our behalf or on the behalf of ones we love. and we call them prayers of intercession. Moses prayed, and he received a word from the Lord. He was asked to construct a bronze snake and lift it high on a pole, the very creature that was killing them. They were required to gaze upon it. Healing for them required a look of faith. Years later, Jesus would be lifted up on a cross. Jesus, the sinless Son of God. In his suffering on the cross, he assumed our identity, as it were, and took on the punishment due to us. He became the substitute. And in this case, a look of faith to that cross of self-sacrifice would give salvation and eternal life to those doomed to die. Christ's sacrificial act ratifies the new covenant. He becomes the sacrificial lamb to take away the sins of the world. There will be no need to sacrifice the blood of flawless lambs anymore. Verse 16 is one of the best known verses of the Old and the New Testament, and is often referred to as the gospel in a nutshell. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. God's motivation toward people is love, and is expressed in the giving of his most precious gift, his unique Son, his only begotten Son. And this gift of love is not limited to a few, or to one particular group of people, but this gift is for the whole world to accept or reject. It will not be earned. Christ's death on the cross and his resurrection is for our redemption. It is our rescue by ransom. Jesus paid a price that freed us from the danger of guilt, enslavement to sin, and expectation of wrath, anger. It is God's act of reconciling us to himself, overcoming his own identity, and overcoming his own hostility to us, that our sins or separation from God. It is through faith only that we can receive this offer of free grace. We then become the righteousness of God and receive the status of adopted children in God's family. The cross is a good news story of the Old Testament, of the New Testament. We will not perish. With that cross comes the promise of eternal life, a life that is eternal not only because it will extend into eternity, but also because it's God's own life. He gives us his life. We become his children, and we have a new heredity. In our baptism, we are made one with Christ in his death and resurrection, and we are raised to new life within and become inheritors of his glorious kingdom. These promises can be read in 2 Corinthians and in Galatians chapter 4. Having the faith means believing and trusting in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In Jesus' day, many were living lives of unrighteousness and were in need of God's saving grace. Many refused to listen and believe. Jesus explains that he came to save and not to condemn. God does not delight in the death of the wicked. He desires everyone to be saved. In Ezekiel 18:32 we read, "For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord. Turn then and live." Not a lot has changed over all these years. The world is still divided between believers and non-believers in Jesus Christ. On Holy Cross Day, we are meant to focus on the cross and to determine its true meaning to us. If we truly believe, we are set free by that cross. It represents unlimited and unconditional love. It is where we can unload all our burdens and worries. Sins are forgiven. The thief on the cross received it in his last hours. The psalmist tells us to sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise to the Lord. The Lord has made known his victory. We need to lift high our voices in praise of the sacrifice of the sinless Son of God for all he has accomplished for us. Paul placed great emphasis on the cross as well. Whenever he went into a city, the first thing he did was to preach Christ and him crucified. He told the saints of Corinth that the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. In Ephesians 3:20, with God's power working in us, God can do much, much more than anything we can ask or imagine. Cross symbols can bring special meaning to us. In ministering to a dying man a short time ago, his request was for a cross to hold in his hand during his last hours. Is there any special cross to you, one you received at some time, or one you gaze upon frequently? My memory of a cross from my childhood was a large iron one found in the Anglican cemetery in the town of Botwood, where I grew up. You see, I lived on Cemetery Road, and the cross was very, very familiar to me. I can remember walking home from Girl Guides at night and fixing my eyes on that large cross as I walked in the road to get to my house. I felt that it was safe. I was safe as long as I could see the cross. So the cross back then had significance to me. You may say that they are only symbols or icons, and that is true. But if they remind us of the infinite love of Jesus Christ, then they serve a purpose. Of course, we all know that that is not enough to recognize the significance of the cross. We are required to do far more than that. We read in Matthew 16:24, then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Our life is to be a life devoted to Jesus. We may never be called to make the ultimate sacrifice, as some Christians have done and continue to do in other parts of the world. They have become martyrs for Christ. In carrying our Christ in Newfoundland today does not include physical danger, but we may often feel lonely, rejected, and sometimes despised. We encounter opposition to our beliefs all the time, and often from those the closest to us. Often you hear, I'm a good person, but I do not need God in my life. Taking up our cross means no longer a life about us, but one about others. But we must remember that despite our sacrifices, we are to lift high the cross of Christ with joy and thanksgiving in our hearts. We are to remain faithful out of love for the one who saved us and gave his life for us on the cross. I came across this verse the other day. Is your cross too heavy to bear? Complainingly, I told myself, this cross is too heavy to wear. And I wondered discontentedly why God gave it to me to bear. And I looked with envy at others whose crosses seemed lighter than mine and wished that I could change my cross for one of a lighter design. And then, in a dream, I beheld a cross I impulsively wanted to wear. It was fashioned of pearls and diamonds and gems that were precious and rare. And when I hung it around my neck, the weight of the jewels and the gold was much too heavy and cumbersome for my small, slender neck to hold. So I tossed it aside, and before my eyes was a cross of rose-red flowers. And I said with delight as I put it on, this cross I can wear for hours. For it was so dainty and fragile, so lovely and light and thin. But I had forgotten about the thorns that started to pierce my skin. And then in my dream I saw my cross, rugged and old and plain, that clumsy old cross I had looked upon with discontented disdain. And at last I knew that God had made a special class for me. For God, in his great wisdom, knew what I before could not see. That often the loveliest crosses are the heaviest crosses to bear. For only God is wise enough to choose a cross to bear. So never complain about your cross, for your cross has been blessed. God made it for you to wear. And remember, God knows best.
This morning, as we confess our faith, I'd like for us to use the Nicene Creed, found on page 188. Let us stand and confess our faith as we say,
we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. In the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I invite you, if you are able, to kneel for the prayers of the people.
For the prayers of the people, we will be using litany number 5, litany number 5, found on page 114. Let us pray that through the witness of your faithful servants, more will come to know and love you as their Savior. In our Anglican Communion, we pray for Rowan, our Archbishop, Fred, our Primate, Percy, our Metropolitan, and David, our Diocesan Bishop. In our Anglican Cycle of Prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Tanzania, the Most Reverend Jacob Erasto Shine Ledev, Archbishop of Tanzania and Bishop of Mwanza. In our tri-diocesan intercessions, we pray for the congregation of the parish of St. Michael and All Angels, Corner Brook, and the rector, the Reverend Canon Alberto Woodman, R.D., and honorable assistant, the Venerable Edward King. And we pray for the parish of Bell Island, the Reverend Ron Lee, Pro Tem, and congregations at St. Cyprian, Bell Island, and St. Mary Ladscole, and Freshwater. We pray for our parish of St. Mary's. We give thanks for Reverend Daphne and her spiritual leadership and dedication in serving us as our priest at St. Mary's over the past 6 years. And your blessing, may your blessing be on her as she retires. And we pray for our incoming clergy, that that person will be supported and encouraged by our people. Be at work in all of us so that what we do will be pleasing in your sight and bring honor and glory to your name. Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray for peace of the world. We pray for cooperation and the desire for peaceful relations among leaders of the nations. We offer thanks for those who are willing to offer themselves
to help secure peace in foreign lands and those who come to the aid of those who are displaced. The Lord grant that we may live together in justice and peace.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for this country of Canada, especially for Elizabeth, our Queen, David Johnston, the Governor General, Stephen Harper, the Prime Minister, and especially today we pray for our newly elected Premier, Paul Davis, and all who are in authority. The Lord help them to serve this people according to his holy will.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for children and young people. We give thanks for keeping our children safe over the summer. We pray for your blessing on them as they return to their places of worship and learning. We pray for those who are off pursuing further education. May they remain faithful to God as they journey into a new phase of life. We ask you to guide their growth and development.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the sick. Today we remember Harold, Heveland, Tyler, Riley, Natalie, Daryl, Reverend Kay, Emma, Reverend Sheila, Reverend John, Blair, Myrtle, Ines, Elizabeth, Huey, Kim, George, Susie, Shirley, Caroline, Eric, Michael, Alice, Pauline, Jeanette, and Joan. And any others known to you, you may pray aloud or in the silence of your heart. The Lord deliver them and keep them in his love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all who are condemned to exile, prison, harsh treatment, or hard labor for the sake of justice and truth. We pray for all who are suffering due to conflicts and civil war. Remember the people of the Ukraine, Syria, Iraq, Gaza, and other troubled areas in the world. May they find hope and relief from their hardships and suffering. Lord, support them and keep them steadfast.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We remember the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and all who have borne witness to the gospel. Help us, Lord, to take up our cross daily and follow you. The Lord, direct our lives in the same spirit of service and sacrifice.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Continuing on page 191, page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's extend the peace of Christ to each other, my friends.
Good morning. Thank you.
our offertory hymn is hymn number 268. Hymn number 268.
Christ, the Lord of glory. Amen.
I invite you now to turn to Eucharistic prayer number 3 on page 198. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, who for our sins was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. By his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore, with all the hosts of heaven who gather around your throne and the Lamb, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation. In calling Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all in the words made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Continuing now on page 211. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
For the breaking of the bread, we will use sentence number 3. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, whose many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread.
So may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
My friends, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
worship is over,
the service begins.